Songs?
You never sing those.
You drop and give me 50.
How do you sing about it?
Like that.
Like that. I need some background pigeons. No. Drop and give me 50.
Welcome to the Claudia Jordan Show. The show where you never know what's going to happen. You make black girls sing opera and sing Drop and Give Me 50.
Yes.
And all kind of stuff happens.
Album coming soon.
Ladies, who's in the house?
Tina Davina here.
That's it?
It's been 2 weeks, girl.
We'll get back to you. Yeah. Who's in the house?
We got to rotate the lineup.
Yeah. Right. Who's in the house?
Portia's in the house.
Who's in the house?
Denisha Danielle.
Who's in the house?
Thor's in the his house.
Yeah, I'm your host, Claudia Jordan. It's been a long 2 weeks, ladies. Man.
Too long.
Tonight's topic is something very interesting. I don't know if it's affected any of you guys personally. The topic is, why are men going overseas, i.e. Brazil and goddamn Dominican Republic, for sex? Call us, call in 877-2106-106. Think about it, call in. We're going to talk and catch up because I haven't seen my girls in a little while. Tina, what you been up to? I haven't seen you in a while. What's
I
been
know.
Up?
I've been on my grind trying to get my book
You've been grinding on somebody? Oh, I was grinding on somebody. I'll get to that later.
I've been trying to get my book done, my poetry book.
Oh, so, good. Something productive.
Yeah, you know. I do that once in a while.
Now, what is the Tina Davina vagina update?
Wait a minute. Somebody no longer.
Are you glowing?
She's glowing.
I've never seen her with the hair back.
Ever.
She is glowing. You got some. Mm-hmm. You got
some. Yeah, she did.
You got some.
Who checked in the hotel Tina Davina?
Oh, my God.
Wow. He knows who he is.
I feel so left out.
Tina Davina, I was a reference on your repossessed truck 10 years ago. I should be the first one to know when your labia minor was violated. You had sex?
No, I didn't have sex, but.
You grinded.
Blowjob.
Dry hump. Anal?
Someone kind of resurfaced in my life, and you know, and I'm kind of going with this little bit of a ride. He doesn't live here.
You rode
a ride, yes.
Oh, so you made love.
Yeah.
Oh. You gotta listen, ladies. You gotta listen. Oh. I didn't have sex.
Tina Davina broke her spell.
He made love.
That's about fucking time, right?
I can tell something different. Yeah, I can tell right away.
I talk to you away. Every day.
I've never seen her hair back. That's
there was like a period
time.
You didn't talk to me.
Exactly. I should have.
No emails.
Should've. We should get an alert, like a Google alert.
Yes.
That's true. I'm sending out a bulletin.
Yes.
When it happens over here,
Denisha and Danielle, we were in Vegas together.
Yes, we were.
Wait a minute.
What happens in Vegas? Stays
not quite.
In Vegas,
three
ladies.
Of us were there.
Do not violate the rule or else it will go the other way.
I think we might have to.
Only because some
there others.
That is like a cardinal sin. You
wait,
can't do that.
What?
No.
I did.
We did see something.
I did see a daytime soap opera person.
Yes.
I did see some action.
He's now on daytime TV on
nighttime. Channel 2.
I did see one of my friends get tongue raped.
Yes.
I witnessed
a serious
it.
Crime.
Tongue rape.
Tonsil hockey.
It is a very serious crime.
I saw both tongues moving.
Yeah.
Force.
Okay. Force.
Force.
You can talk about that later. But you did. You were
another
giggling.
Show. Another
were,
show.
You didn't stop.
You were giggling.
Okay, maybe you're right.
Whatever.
Oh, my girls are coming out of there. Hey,
he's
males.
Cute.
Oh,
a tall one.
Ooh, that's just walked in the room.
Laura Santiago.
Yes, ma'am.
What have you been up to?
I didn't do anything online. Last weekend, right? That's what we're talking about.
Vagina updates. Cut the chair. Yeah, I don't care about redecorating.
You still got regular dick?
My vagina's working overtime right now.
Ain't this about a bitch?
I gotta please a 25-year-old man who does.
He's 25 now?
Yeah, he just
I thought he was 23. You lying.
No, he's 25.
He was 19.
I thought he said he was 23 like a while ago.
He's 37.
Really? He was 24.
I would love it.
So you guys still
have it? Yeah, it's still on and going. And again, thank you for my birthday gift because I put those draws to good use.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thank you very much.
Don't mention
you,
it.
Thank you very much.
I know my girl. Portia, need I ask? Yes. You were with me in Vegas as well.
Yeah, we were in Vegas.
You left early. I think the goings on were a bit much for you.
The goings on? No, it wasn't a bit much. It was fun, but.
Sorry I came in every day at 10 a.m.
I'm talking about whole stroll every morning.
Really?
Rolling over, you know, I'm
and
about
you guys
to wake
are talking
up.
About me?
Oh, yeah, but she said it, so I could talk about it. You know, you hear a little room key.
Wait, how about I came in so late one day, I didn't turn the light on, I just sat upright in a chair.
Okay, let's say I was scared, right? It's dark. All the curtains are, I'm serious. I hear something. And I'm like, what is that noise?
I'm breathing hard not to throw up.
And I kid you not, all I see is a silhouette sitting in a chair.
Upright.
And she's like, who is that? Because there was a few of us in the room. And I was like, Claudia. I was like, did you just get in?
So no, I couldn't sleep.
She couldn't sleep. I turned on the light and she still had the same dress on.
Lying.
From 10 p.m.
Walk of shame.
That night. But she texted me kind of a little beforehand saying, whole stroll. But I was asleep, so I didn't really get it. And I was like,
but my whole stroll, I was playing craps.
Really?
I was gambling.
Yeah.
I was gambling.
Right.
I was gambling. I was rolling the dice. Rolling. Shaking.
Literally.
In your hand. Ooh, crap.
Sounds like a piece of crap what you're saying, but okay.
No, I was gambling. I actually turned $300 into $5,600.
I like it.
That takes a lot of time, a lot of work. So I didn't come home with money.
Yeah.
At rehab, me and Portia were the only ones sober. So it was kind of obnoxious. You started to realize.
It was.
And that day I vowed to quit drinking. That was on
Sunday. Yeah.
So I went 2 days.
And I figured, and I thought it would last a day, personally.
Till last Tuesday, I went out to go and saw a cutie pie, and it was all out the door.
Busted by
and then
the
you're like, Caso!
by the security, the Mexicano.
We'll get back to that
security.
Later. I'm telling way too much business. But anyways, welcome to the show. The topic tonight, I don't know if you guys have any dealings with this, about men going overseas for sex. Really, we're talking about Brazil. That's definitely a major place where, a pit stop, where guys in the United States, the average guy can go over there with a few $100 in his pocket, and he's like Puff Daddy.
Literally.
Mm-hmm. And he's doing it real big. And I've been told my ex-boyfriend went to Brazil with his friends. And to this day, his boy's like, oh, my God, you had a good boyfriend because he didn't do anything. We all did something. He's the only one that didn't do anything. I'm like, so? Am I supposed to be flattered? Like, I didn't do anything when I went to
anywhere.
What city is this?
You can't even think of a place.
Caribbean.
When I went to the swap meet,
when you were on Slauson.
She's like, let me think of a place where I was good.
I was the same. But he wanted credit for it. I didn't understand the hype. But I'm reading this book by author Jewel Woods. It's called "Don't Blame It on Rio: The Real Reason, the Real Deal Behind Why Men Go to Brazil for Sex." And the women there, the average woman I hear that's pumping gas is absolutely beautiful. She got ass. She got hair down her back. She got a long eyelash. She got a tan. Fuck them hoes. I hate them.
It's not true though.
God,
it's totally not
so
true.
So you went to Brazil.
I've been to Brazil.
How are the guys there? We always hear about the girls, but how are the guys?
The guys are kind of
are they cheesy?
Little girly guys.
Yeah. Mm. Androgynous looking.
Yeah, like, they don't look very. I mean, they're not like young, strapping men like at all.
Where's the place for the girls to go where there's a mecca of men?
I think
a mecca of men who treat you well and honor you and respect you. That's basically the equivalent.
No, we're not looking for honor or respect at this point. Just speak for yourself.
Come out of our home chat. Give us a call. Call us. Call in 877-2106-106.
Yeah.
So my ex-boyfriend went, and he went with some friends that, you know, guys, they don't always hang around in packs of cute guys. So there's one leader of the pack, and then the rest are like a pack of wolves.
Right.
And like jackals, kind of. His friends were of lesser visual quality. And they came back with videotape and pictures of girls doing all kind of ungodly things in the shower. And they were some pretty girls. Mm-hmm. And they said they gave these girls like $50. And there's a club where it's like all dimes, all Alicia Keys, Halle Berry types, they say. I mean, I'm sure they gassed it up a bit. All had sex every night. And a lot of them, a couple of guys had girlfriends and wives. And they got a popping. Mm-hmm. Carlos, Colin, if you've been in Brazil and you've sampled some of the whores in Brazil, give us a call, 877-2106-106. Anybody know anyone that's gone to Brazil and then it had this kind of adventure? You've been to Brazil, so tell us.
Yeah.
Tell us. Mm-hmm. Speak on it, please.
Well, actually, I was very curious about the whole prostitute phenomenon down there. So I asked the cab driver to take us to the clubs where they do this. Mm-hmm. And they said, No, there's no place for you there. You can't go. No. And I was like, take me to where you go. First of all, they won't even let you in. As an American woman, you cannot go to the club.
Haters.
Wow.
But we sat outside and we watched what happened. And when you say like the average guy is P. Diddy, I'm talking like not even the average guy.
Making it rain with like nickels?
Yes, basically. And the women do approach them. The women come up to them. They start rubbing their shoulders and they're like whispering in their ears, being very like forward and aggressive. Mm-hmm. And the men, we talked to one of them because he approached us thinking we were Brazilian hookers. And he
said, that happens.
Happens all the time. But anyway, he came up to us and he said,
well, all that ass you have.
Exactly. It's the problem I have everywhere I go.
Right.
Yeah.
But so he came and he was telling us, you know, but they're not like hookers. They really like you.
Wow.
And he was like, she really is attracted to me. And I was like, but you don't speak the same language as she does. Mm-hmm. And he said, well, she says a few words. And he's like, but when you have chemistry, you just have chemistry.
The funny thing is they probably think these girls speak Spanish and they speak Portuguese.
Yes.
That's the funny thing. They have no idea. Yes. We have one of our regulars on the phone. I'm sure you can guess who it is. It's Iceberg from Queens. Iceberg.
Hey,
what's up?
Hey.
What's good, man? That's some real sucker shit right there. That's some weak-ass niggas. They can't deal with the strong women over here, so they got to go across seas and all these places. Agreed. That's some sucker shit, man. If you're a real Mac, you can Mac anybody, man.
Yeah. See, the argument, Iceberg, some of these men say that, you know, with the women in Brazil, they don't get any drama. Like, you know, it speaks volumes. It actually plays into what you're saying here. They can't really, they don't really get the respect, and they don't get sweated and jocked like they would in overseas in a third world country.
Mm-hmm. The only people who get away with that shit and really want to do that is married men. You know, you go to another country, you can act a fool. How wife you gonna find out what you're doing in another country?
True that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Do you have any friends that have gone over to Brazil and had sex with these pretty prostitutes?
Nah, we don't do things like that because, man, you fuck around and bring something back home with you really don't want, man. The rate of AIDS and all them diseases over there, that shit just don't interest me. Me and my people won't do no shit like that.
Well, I wish there were more men that thought like that. I mean, I'm hearing that the statistics are going up every year of men that are going over and making that trip to Brazil. You know, the dollar's weak here now, but in Brazil, it still carries some weight, so they can still live like kings. And that's what this book is talking about, how they get on there and they have the lifestyle they feel like America has, like, not allowed them to have. I say work harder. And get your mouthpiece and your game up.
Yeah.
You know. There's plenty of dimes in the United States.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Hey, babe, right? You know what it is?
Absolutely.
Get your money up. Get your money up first and become something real strong that you're an asset to a woman. I mean, if you want to take the sucker way out and go through a third world country or something where people is broke and things like that. But, I mean, on a more serious tip, man, you know, God's got to be careful with that, man. You fuck around and go get something you really wasn't looking for, player.
Iceberg. I can't help but to notice you're sounding a little down tonight. Where's your swag, baby? What's wrong? Are you okay? Do you have something you want to get off your chest? What's wrong?
You let it sound a little limp.
Nah, well, I'll tell you what it really is. I just woke up. I had a long day at work, 16 hours. But other than that, I just woke up to hear your show. But yeah, you can't be leaving us with all these weeks. I know you're getting all that paper, but y'all got to give us a best of or a replay.
No, barefoot wine. Anyways, Memorial Day weekend, nobody was around. Nobody wanted to work, so we couldn't come in. So I really missed it. I actually did the show by myself in my shower. Topic was masturbation. We always appreciate your call, so thank you so much, Iceberg. Yes,
they gotta give you one more hour, man. 1 hour is just not enough for y'all, man. When the show start getting good, y'all gotta leave us, man. But I'll catch y'all tomorrow at 10 o'clock.
That's right.
We appreciate your support, Iceberg.
Thank you.
No doubt, sweetie. Peace.
Bye.
I like him.
Iceberg is coming a little softer.
You know what I like about Iceberg? He has different layers. He's like hard, then he's soft, then he's sensitive, then he loves his wife, then he doesn't. It's great.
Just like a head of lettuce. You peel back
different layers. Well, ice has different forms. It's hard, like ice.
Mm-hmm. And when
it's soft, like a cumulus cloud. Then it's like fluid, like water. Love it.
Iceberg, he just got a nice shout out right there. I hope
Iceberg, we love you. Yeah. We've got Thomas from Houston. Have you been to Rio, Thomas? Thomas.
Yes, ma'am. I've been.
Oh, tell us about it, Thomas.
It was a different experience. It really was. I've been there and I've been to the District of Columbia. I'm sorry. Dominican. I mean the Dominican.
Okay, I was like, D.C. is in the States, babe.
Oh, those D.C. girls. They're really exotic. They're really exotic looking. Bring your passport. No, okay, go ahead. Dominican Republic. I'm really interested to hear about the Dominican Republic because I had some friends recently that went to the Dominican Republic.
Mm.
And I just am curious to know, like, how was it for
them? It was just like what you heard. A couple of my homeboys, when we went out there, you know, they stocked up on Viagra and everything. And I was like, what are you getting that for? Wait, you're going to see. You're going to see.
And wasting all that hard dick on foreigners.
What a shame.
I object.
And I swear, the minute we got off the plane, it was like we it made us feel like we were kings, you know, like greedy, just whatever
exactly
you wanted to do. And I just couldn't believe it. It was an experience that was just a little different. It was a little more, it's more catered to what a man, some of these guys out here looking for that they can't get out here in the States.
Now, Thomas, why can't you get that in the United States? What's your lifestyle like here? What do you do?
I'm a real estate broker.
So you should have paper and status.
Yeah, it's fine. I'm okay. It's just,
clearly you're not, though, if you have to go to a third world country and encourage the prostitution ring that's going on.
I want to go see it and check it out. I didn't believe it, but, you know, it was different. It was different. Something I just had to do that I hadn't done.
And did you have protected sex, or did you go raw dog? Be honest. No one knows.
Honestly, I didn't have sex. That wasn't my style. I just wanted to go see the country.
Okay.
But if I would have, I would have.
Did you make out? Grind?
Dry hump at least?
Get a blowjob?
Hold hands?
Wait, are you married? Is that why you didn't do anything?
No, I'm not married.
He just went to Brazil for the scenery.
For the curiosity's sake. How are the beaches?
Is there sand?
Sea turtles? All right, thank you very much, Thomas. That was
right.
I don't think he was being honest.
Okay, we about to take a break. Call in. Our topic tonight is why are men going overseas, especially to Brazil, for sex? Call in. If you have a friend that went, if you went, give us a fake name. We won't know.
Ladies,
would you let your man go overseas on a guy's trip? Oh, we're just going to Brazil to see the sights and the sounds and to see the food, eat the food. I want to learn Portuguese. Call in, 877-2-106-106.
How you doing?
How are you? Hey, haters. Haters in Vegas.
Haters.
Oh, man.
I'm sure.
Movie star haters.
What list? Ain't haters, that about a bitch?
Bitch haters. Dude haters. Dude. Oh, your party's going to be empty.
Ours is going to be more popular than yours.
You're hosting that?
Let it go.
Yes, the topic tonight, why are our African-American men going to Brazil and overseas to get sex when there's five haughty and non-touch, except Tina Davina, women waiting to give it up to someone that would just call us back? Call me back.
Hello.
Is it me so you're looking for?
It's so cold.
It's not that hard.
It's not.
I don't think it's that hard.
Keep looking, fellas.
It's not that hard.
It's hard.
It's not.
It should be hard, but when we get
to they have to go. They have so many options in the United States, and then they're still greedy enough to go overseas and get more.
Mm-hmm.
We're like, I mean, the older you get, you put up with more and more crap because you're like, well, fuck.
Right.
I mean, shit.
But yeah, the men out here don't want to do the whole routine of the courtship and everything. You go to Brazil, just whip out your dick. You be like, hey.
Yeah, throw a dollar bill on it.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. So simple.
Wrap a quarter on it.
That kind of shows us. That kind of shows us what guys are looking for. Just like the hit it, quit it.
Mm-hmm. Portia, you need to quit playing.
I think you're looking for the ego stroke.
I think it's Portia's fault that dudes are going to Brazil.
She ain't had sex since 2005.
And that's the problem, right?
That's
there.
The problem. Bitches like you, they're not like, giving it up.
Lock and
key, baby. Lock and key. Gotta
that's
work
right.
for it.
I agree.
Chastity belt.
Hey.
Kind of.
Yeah. Misha, you too. You're next. Okay.
I'm just a tongue whore.
You are. You are.
I like it.
Yes.
Hey, it's a tongue whore.
Herpes does get on the mouth.
Okay. Oh, God.
Speaking
of
tongue whores, Tina Davina, we've got your poetry.
All right.
How about that for starting?
Go ahead, girl. Hey, wrap like, them lips around.
I am a tongue whore. Poets. How do you like
good
that segue?
With their tongues.
Okay, ladies, let's be quiet.
Yes.
It's a very serious and integral part of the
show.
Integral?
Integral.
Eh, fucking important.
Integral.
Whatever. Go ahead, Neffa.
Let's see if we need some sound effects.
I'm jealous you had sex.
It was good, too.
I did grind. Sorry. Good.
He was so hot that I saw him through crowded bodies dancing. He was glancing my way. I had to play it cool, didn't want to look like a fool, but he was looking tasty. In my mind, I thought, he could take me, but nah, that's not my game. Hell, I don't even know his name, and so I danced some more. But then I felt his walk part the floor like he was Moses on the Great Sea. Is everyone watching me? I felt my heart stop and my stomach drop just a little, and I needed to breathe. Damn, girl, he is only he can't be doing all this to me. And then he asked me my name, and riff-raff, blasé. I said, huh? What? Wait, what did you say? With all this music, I can't hear. And so he leaned into me so near I could feel the warm breath on my ear. And I swear, I think he burned my hair because his shit was on fire. And I offered him a tic-tac and walked my ass back to the bar.
right on.
Okay. Hey, completely off.
Well, maybe not. Maybe you that's know, what the Brazilian women
I,
really think.
I couldn't really think of anything that rhymed with, like, Brazilian pussy. It didn't work. So.
Should we try something right now, maybe?
Let's
go for
okay,
it.
I've been dating 3 months. And he loved my lady lumps, but yet he still booked a flight. He landed the next night, and he tried to get some pussy that was more tight from a chick named Lola. The bitch fucked him for a quota. She was just a regular civilian. Fuck! My man had sex with a Brazilian.
Oh, no, right on! Right on! Right on!
Right on!
Right on.
Right on.
I'm gonna lose my poetry spot. I'm gonna lose it.
I like the quota.
What rhymes with quota?
Quota.
Man.
Okay.
Quota.
Back. Thank you, Tina, for the random moment of the day.
I love it.
You know what? They can't. She's been on every week. They can't all be relevant.
Can't all
stop it.
Exactly.
Hit or miss.
It's all good.
I love it.
Good job. And a swing and a miss.
Thank you, Tina Davina, for the random
and
poem.
I think she has sex, and now she's all
right.
thrown off.
Yeah, totally.
You ain't that was her no little. Poem. That was her little love dedication.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah that
don't
yeah.
be dedicated.
Totally made your equilibrium just a little yeah. bit
you don't
off.
Sound, you don't sound thirsty.
No sex for you next week. Okay, ladies, back on track. The book is called "Don't Blame It on Rio." We've got the author of this book, Jewel Woods. Jewel Woods, welcome to the show.
Ladies, how y'all doing?
We're great. How you doing? Do you like my poem?
You know what? Y'all, wow.
Brazilian yeah. bitches ain't got nothing on us.
For real.
No, wait, I like wait. It a lot.
So tell us, what inspired you to write this book?
What inspired me to write the book?
Yes.
Yeah, in fact, tell me actually if I'm going in and out. For some reason, the phone is going out. But what inspired me to write the book were the stories that the brothers were telling me. I've been dealing with so-called men's issues for the majority of my adult life, trying to figure out what makes men tick, what makes them think, what makes them feel the way they do, and obviously why they do what they do. And when I had an opportunity in 2005 to get a professional fellowship to organize men's groups, one of the things that I found out was that it wasn't just the men who were, you know, having problems on the block that had stories to tell. And I was finding out that there was a lot of middle-class and professional black men who were having some very powerful and potent experiences overseas, and they wanted to share them. So I found that to be a contradiction, to say the least. And over, you know, a couple years, the more and more I talked to brothers, the more and more I found that it was not a small phenomenon and that it was this deep, penetrating experience for a lot of men.
Oh, now this is getting interesting. I'm sorry, can you say that last part again?
One, that it was just bigger than I had ever imagined it to be, and
yeah,
not just big
word,
in terms of the numbers of men that had gone, but big in terms of how powerful the experiences were for the men. So, I mean, the basic contradiction were, I think what you've been saying is, why on earth would some of the men who are perhaps the most coveted brothers on the planet, why would they feel the need to be traveling overseas? So, I mean, to throw, you know, a little monkey wrench, it's not just about sex. I mean, the book is not about sex, in fact, at all. It's about sexuality. So that's what inspired me to write the book.
I noticed you mentioned that, you know, something that keeps coming up in the book is that men claim that they just get treated better over there and that African-American women are just too hard to deal with. So they just kind of throw their hands up, book a flight on Expedia.com or whatever it is, and go down there and get treated right, how they should be treated. What do you think that's saying about black women as a whole?
It's not saying a lot. I mean, to be quite honest, I mean, one of the things that anybody who works with men knows is the stuff that they say about women is that they're often saying about themselves. So, yeah, you get those brothers who say a lot about you know, that this is something that black women are compelling them, right, to take these trips overseas because of the way in which they're treated here. That's more like on the first read. I mean, when you really talk to black men, you find out that there's all types of things that's going on in their lives, from aging to catching hell at a job, to having some profound questions about their own sexuality, insecurity, lack of relationships with other men.
Don't you think this is just an excuse? Because the group of brothers that I knew that went over there, one was my boyfriend at the time, and then his friends, and then one of them was happily married, had a great woman. I mean, he was not cute. He was lucky that he had his wife, basically. But he went over there, and it's just like, you know, he wasn't one of those guys that were lonely and didn't have anything going on here. He did, but it was like just being, is it just greedy? It's just like a sport, just go over there just for fun? Like, is Brazil the new PlayStation 3?
You know what? It's deeper than that because, you know what? Now, that's a funny way of putting it. I think that part of what ends up happening, though, is that I try not to over, you know, gauge this phenomenon because it's not like every brother's running over there. But at the same time, the real question is, you know, will every brother go over there if they get a chance? So will every brother play PlayStation? I don't know. But will every brother want to feel like Will Smith? Will every brother want to feel like, you know, Puffy or Denzel? And this coach would answer, you know, to be quite honest, is yes. And so what you said about that, your boyfriend's partner, you know, is not a small thing about that he was lucky to get a woman, perhaps because of how he looked, maybe because he was small. And my guess is that he perhaps felt that same way, and he didn't talk to anybody about it. So him going over there, and again, this is not to excuse brothers, and I'm the last cat to make excuses for grown-ass men. But what you end up finding out once you listen to them is that there's a lot of shit going on in their lives, and quite often men don't talk about stuff. And so the way in which they end up trying to express themselves is by trying to be King Dingaling by going overseas. So you're right. I have to admit that. But at the same time, you know, there's a lot of things that's funny, frightening, and fascinating about men that this stuff overseas unfortunately ends up trying to answer for them, as opposed to them trying to work out their stuff with their relationships with black women here.
Hey, Jewel, this is Denisha. And I've been to Brazil, and I researched this a little bit because I was really fascinated by it. And the truth of the matter, I'm good. How are you doing?
I'm doing all right.
All right. The truth of the matter is that 15 million people in Brazil make less than a dollar a day, and over 40 million make less than $2 a day.
Right.
So these American men that are making, let's just say, $30,000 a year are going over there and acting like billionaires. And for their ego stroke, they are taking advantage of very, financially impoverished
right.
women and children, actually. Every hotel I went to, they said child rape is a crime in Brazil. You can't have sex with children. Please report it. So this is actually a very serious catastrophe about what's happening in Brazil. So for these men and their quote unquote ego stroke and making them feel like a king, if that's more important than these people, I mean, if they want to do something nice with their money, maybe they can donate to some causes down there instead
Absolutely.
Of
there's
going
no
down there.
About that. There's no question about it. Here's what I would want to do, though, because part of the answer to your question is there's other poor countries too, right? So part of the question ends up being, well, why Brazil and why not, let's say, Thailand? So
they do it in Thailand.
Philippines
white men
too.
Do it in Thailand all the time.
But the Brazilians have the most ass,
yes.
That's why.
Right. So what did you say?
The Brazilians have the most ass, so that's why. It's like they got the white woman hair, the black woman booty,
right.
And they don't speak English. Well, that's the perfect
world.
Yeah, we get into that in that one chapter, Fat, Black, and Ugly, right? Because for whatever reason, Brazilian women have been coded as, this sort of Frankenstein mixture, as you just said, black and white. And so they're neither black nor white, and brothers get a chance to choose between both. But to your point, Denise, and I'm not denying that, on one level, this is about sex tourism, right? Sex tourism is this phenomenon that's a product of global capitalism where men get an opportunity to go overseas and act like
donkeys.
Be involved with erotic and exotic women. But the reality is that black men don't go to those other places. So, again, there is something about Brazil. And if it's just the booty, as you just said, or the Brazilian bunda, that's a part of it. But the other thing is, and this is where I think I did hear the one clip where the one guy was saying, I think he was lying, to be quite honest, that he didn't have sex while he was over there.
Yes.
But there are other reasons why, some men who, are 6'4", do got, make way more than $30,000 a year, right, do have women at their beck and call, still feel like there's something about their lives that they feel like they can tap into by stepping outside of this country, right?
Taboo.
On one hand, and I'm just saying cultural tourism is a multi-billion-dollar industry, right, where black folks go all over the world to try to get connected to what they think is their sort of cultural roots. And so that's, and again, that's not saying that brothers don't go over there, they don't act like they, they don't end up doing some of these things. But when you're a black man in this country and you end up feeling like you can't get seen for what you have achieved, right, there's a chapter in the book called So This Is What It Feels Like to Be a White Man. For the first time I hear black men saying, and I've never been, let me just, make that very upfront. I've never been, I've never been out of the country. But what I hear both black men and black women tell me, that it makes sense that they need to step outside of this country just to exhale, that makes some sense. Now, obviously, at the end of the day, as you just said, Denise, you got women and children who are poor, and they are part of that construction of making you feel like you are, right, not just an American, but you've achieved, then that just makes the situation even more complicated. It doesn't belittle it or take it away, but you got black folks who feel like they can't be seen for anything in this country simply because of their race.
I feel, this is Claudia here, and I feel like that
Claudia.
A lot of times black men make, not just black men, well, I'm going to just talk about black men right now,
sure.
Make excuses about why they don't have what they have. It's someone else's fault. It's the white man's fault. It's the black woman's attitude. How about you try a little bit harder? I know a lot of underachievers that have such a sense of entitlement and why don't I have this? Why don't you work harder? You know, there,
let me
you
ask
can,
you this, you, right. So let me ask you this, Claudia. So one of the questions, so part of what I'm asking everybody these days, and this is just where you push me because I have no problem at all, is what do we want to learn about men's lives? Because on one hand, you know, perhaps people don't even have to read this book to be able to just say, you know, this is what black men are, and or even this is what women are, because that's what ends up happening. Brothers have everything to say about black women, but they never have done anything to actually explore black women's lives. And so I reject that whole premise. But part of, you know, what I would ask you is, what is it about men's lives that we want to know? You know, for example, does it make sense then, you know, not making excuses, that a guy who's getting older, a guy who's in his 40s and 50s, for the first time in his life is really having to deal with a sort of decline in his sexuality? That kind of makes some sense, just in, when it comes to sort of aging process. The question for men is, how in the hell do they begin to make decisions about what it means to be having healthy sex as an older being? Does that mean, for example, having sex with a woman that's 20 years your junior? Does it mean, for example, popping Viagra and Levitra, you know, by the bucket because now you get to perform like you were when you were 18 or 19? I've been in this culture, Claudia, and I think that you're right, we just don't have those conversations with men and boys. I mean, the ways in which men and boys become to learn about their sexuality is through their father's stash up under the couch.
No, you're right.
And
I don't want you to feel like I'm attacking your book. I'm actually glad you wrote this book, and I think more men need to be honest and come out and talk about these things. I don't want you to feel like I'm attacking your book, but I just have to play devil's advocate here because it is
No, I please do.
And, you know, no, I just...
I work with men who batter, so I can take any sort of, like, critique. So let me just put that out
there. No, but I'm not critiquing you. I'm talking about men, and I'm talking about men that do this. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, I feel like a lot of times... And as a black woman, I feel like we're at the short end of the stick, so to speak, because... It affects us, you know, like the more of our men that go over there, and I read in your book where you say some of them are going and settling down, relocating, marrying these women. We already have enough obstacles trying to marry a black man in the United States with the gay men, the guys that don't like black women anymore. I was in Chicago this weekend. There was a really cute guy that was hanging with us, and he's like, I don't fuck with black women anymore. I only date white girls.
Your face?
He said it to my face.
Wow.
And he's like, but you cool, though.
Did you tell him I'm Claudia Shaw?
No, I wasn't trying to holler at him, though. But I'm just saying, you know, it was just like... To just make such a blanket statement, I'm just like, I feel like there's really a war right now between black men and black women, and I think black women, we're losing. You know,
oh,
I feel
God,
like
yes.
There's more and more of us that are without partners, and I read in your book, I did read your book.
Right, well, thank most you.
That you said you compared stats from, I think, 1965 to now as far as marriages, and before it was like 32% of unmarried black women, and now it's up to like 60% of unmarried women who've never been married. And that's a really sad thing that 60% of my sisters, not me, fuck that, that we're not going to be able to walk down the aisle, we're not going to have that wedding, and we're not going to have a guy that's going to pledge that he loves us. Like, I think that's a sad thing that's happening, and we got to do something about it, because...
Well, and so let me just honor you, and let's say whatever fool said that to your face, you know, needs to be sort of held accountable for it. And I think that that's what this book tries to do. And I'm saying part of what, again, going back to this whole idea of, you know, what is the sort of value of exploring men's lives, it's for the first time, you know, not even just talking about the statistics about, you know, how horrible it is to be a sister. For the first time, you got men who have money who've never had a sort of opportunity to be different. So I'm saying that without having this sort of conversation, and again, and let me just be very upfront, it's sisters that's actually calling me on the show to have this conversation. You know, there's very few brothers that have put me on their shows, and so that ends up being a sort of perpetuation of power. So until brothers get a chance to talk about, okay, now I make $30,000 or $40,000 a year, for the first time in my life, I got, you know, all types of opportunities. I can either, you know, have sex with, you know, a number of different sisters in Chicago or Detroit or D.C., and or I can go overseas. What are the real sort of questions that are going to be in my life to help me be different? What I'm saying is that just hasn't happened before, partly because, you know, the black middle class has never really been talked about seriously. This book was, you know, for me as an academic, a very big step, you know, outside of what is supposed to be, you know, a traditional academic career. And the only reason why I did it, Claudia, is because there are no books that certainly sociologists write about professional black men. We always talk about the brother on the block, the brother that got shot and, you know, wearing cornrows and grills. And that's an important ass story to tell. That's my story.
How do you feel about kind of blowing the whistle on this phenomenon and kind of bringing a light to it? Like, how did you get a lot of flack from all the brothers about it? Like, man, why are you telling
them? No, that's what I'm saying. But they don't have to say anything. That's part of the, you know, that's part of privilege. It's like white people never really having to talk about, you know, the things that they do. I'm saying as long as men don't say anything or say something backwards like the guy that you did, then you can never engage guys. You know, like I said, I work with men who battle. The only guys who get an opportunity to talk about male privilege and patriarchy and all this sort of stuff that feminists talk about are guys that are court mandated and, you know, and are trying to stay out of jail. So this book is about having a conversation with, you know, legions of men, the majority of whom, you know, have no particular responsibility to black women. The first chapter in this book is called, you know, Are Black Women Necessary, right? And your readers should know, your listeners should know that, you know, the chapter titles are sort of provocative, not just sort of. But that book, you know, everybody has asked, you know, why the hell did you start off a book with a, you know, a provocative-ass question like that? And to your point, the majority of black women, you know, by the time they're age 18, are going to have to ask this question about whether or not they go marry a black man, you know, perhaps even earlier. But black men don't have to grow up with that sort of burden, right? We never have to grow up wondering whether or not we go marry a black woman. And I'm saying the fact that we don't have to even have that conversation is an act of privilege. So to not have that conversation with my son who's 15, you know, early and often about, one, you know, what is your sort of unique position as a, you know, guy who's going to be college educated, right? He's a little shorty too, right? But, and perhaps because you go catch, you know, hell, you don't fit this whole model of tall, dark, and handsome, you little short cat, how do you deal with those sort of contradictions? And let me just put it back on sisters, right? One of the things that sisters, I think, have an opportunity to sort of, you know, coach men on is whether or not they do things like settle, right? So one of the things that men, you know, just to go back to whether or not they're making excuses or not, Claudia, and this is where I'd have y'all chime in, is do sisters settle? Because some of the men who, you know, to go back to your friend and his wife, right? If men feel like that women just settle because they get 30 and 35 and they really don't want them, right? They just want their circumstances. How the hell is that any different than a guy who's saying, well, I just might as well go get the, you know, the finest ass woman overseas?
Well, hold that thought because I am 35. We're going to think about that. We're going to go to break. Stay with us. We're going to come back after the break. The topic is why do men go, blow the whistle.
You didn't lost your train of thought. Oh, sorry. That.
Why do I dance and blow the whistle in the club? No, why do men go to Brazil with sex? Coming back after the break, 877-2-106-106. We've got author Jewel Woods. Give us a call. Hey. Party. I was me last night. I was kind of slow dancing to a fast song last night.
Slow dancing?
Who does that?
She was dancing to Usher.
A drunk person.
I was kind of booed up last night.
Hardcore.
Booed? Slow dancing to a fast song.
She was asking questions if we look good together. Do we look good together?
I was slow dancing to a fast song.
The life of the party.
I felt like I was in a video. Like I was doing my hair thing.
Were you whipping the hair around, girl?
Yes.
It was nice.
Murder.
Was the lip gloss shiny?
No. In your mind, you think it looks beautiful. And then in real life, it's like
it just looks drunk.
This is just a drunk bitch.
This is pure intoxication.
No. I was like, you're hot.
Drool coming out of her mouth.
You think I'm hot?
All night. She's serious.
Do you watch Deal or No Deal? I'm number one, you know. It's a top show on NBC.
I'm briefcase number one.
Do you want my number? No. Hey, your friend.
I'm a big celebrity and all.
I'm a big celebrity. Go to celebrity events all the time. Red carpets, MTV parties, all that. You guys know. Anyways, our topic is why do men go to Brazil? And Dominican Republic.
And the Philippines.
Sounds so
and
bitter. Thailand. Ah.
Do you guys remember that one caller that was talking about he went to Thailand and he had like a basket of seven women or something like that?
That was Philippines. That was Philippines.
I remember that.
That was studio guest.
But yeah, that was Philippines.
It's worldwide.
You know what's not fair, ladies, Space. Listeners? It's not fair. There's no, okay, with men, they can bond. They can play basketball with each other and bond and slap each other in the ass. I cannot go get MAC lip gloss with y'all. I'd be like, hey, Flora, love the shade.
This
I can't do that.
A lesbo.
There's no bonding things that we can do. It's very out for self. You know, we don't go, there's no place we can go and be like, hey, we gonna go fucking.
We gonna look for some dick, girl.
We gonna get some dick in the Grand Canyon.
I wanna wake up with a dick in my mouth tomorrow.
I don't know. I think there's a whole bunch of like 21, 22 year old girls that would disagree.
No, I would like a place where you would go find a man who treats you well, he calls you back, he takes you to dinner, he shows up on time. What country is that?
That would be in the country
that would
the
be planet.
That'd be the bizarro world.
Yeah. That's what that would be. We got past that about 30 minutes ago. Yes. That is not the reality.
Jewel, Jewel, my question to you, it's so not fair. Like, where's a place where random penises attached to good-looking guys are running around wild, disease-free, and attached to a 700 credit score? Crickets.
Okay. Crickets.
Never mind. Back to the big booty Brazilian bitches. Jewel, are you there?
I am there.
Okay.
You're here.
I have a question to Sina Davina here. I feel like a lot of times that
men are not necessarily being honest with women here in the United States.
You don't say.
I'm saying, you know, that's just my
They're not saying,
hey, I want to do it this way or that way. And because they're, you know, they kind of have this fear of being, you know, looked upon as being too perverse or whatever. And so they're going overseas to these third world countries and, you know.
Do you mean like giving up anal?
Anal, reverse
cowgirl?
Yeah, exactly.
That's reverse.
Or doing the basket spin on the dick.
According to Flora, anal might not be that easy. But anyway, I'm sorry. I'm saying that I feel like they're going over there because they can do these things that we American women may shy upon or, you know, frown upon. And these women there are like, no, come on, go ahead. You know, I'm good with that. What do you think?
No, they're definitely saying that. I mean, there's a chapter called The Frigid Black Woman where men are very explicit about how they think that women, particularly black women and American women in general, feel a sort of sense of detachment and shame to sex, right? And again, the reason why I try to sort of preface that, you know, the book is not just about sex or sexuality, because what you hear men talking about is it's not just the sex act, it's people's sort of attitudes about sex that they find, particularly for sisters, that they find so problematic. So you got a guy, and I forget his name, but I'm pretty sure, one of the things that he said was that, you know, the sort of sex that he's had with black women feels sort of obligatory and sort of dutiful. So a sister would do with him what, you know, what he wants him to do. But he's saying, look, that's not what I just, it's not about me. And so these guys get it twisted partly because when they go overseas, they have such explosive sex, right? Exploratory. You mentioned anal. And then they come back and they hold black women and American women in general to that standard. But again, that's a question that only women can answer. I mean, it's groups of sisters like you who can say whether or not it's true. I mean, the data tends to support that black women don't have as much anal sex or fellatio.
I agree that American women.
No, I think we don't talk about it. I think that there are equally freaky black women. I've titty fucked before. When I was bigger, I may have let a finger in the old
side.
In the nether regions.
But have you let a dude piss on you? That's what I'm saying.
That's the question.
Not on purpose. I'm just saying, if you ask questions or get you drunk enough, it might be going down.
We may divulge those secrets, absolutely.
Now, Jewel, love the name, by the way. What do you want people to get from your book? What do you want them to take away from your book? And are you getting head right
now? Because it sounds like it.
Slurp sounds.
You have a Brazilian on your lap right now.
Hello?
Hello.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm back. The phone went out. What was the question?
Wow. Yeah.
I was just wondering what you would... This is a bizarre world, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I want to know, what do you want people to get from your book? What do you want them to take away from your book? When they walk away, if they read your book?
There's like 15 different chapters in the book, right? So each chapter tries to explore a different sort of aspect of men's lives, right? One of the chapters, I've been listening to all the nice hip-hop during the break, and, you know, one of the chapters talks about the impact of hip-hop on middle-class masculinity. You know, one of the things that we don't talk about in this culture is the impact of hip-hop on not just poor folks or women, but on middle-class men. And so you got that guy, and I think in that particular chapter, that's the one who had sex with more than 7 different women in a day, and that's partly because, like a lot of middle-class men that I've sort of interviewed, there's a sort of sense that they get sort of obliterated. They're not seen, right? That their sort of physicality and their sexuality is not represented on, you know, the average video. So in that chapter, one of the things I want to get is whether or not we can have serious conversations about issues that we typically don't talk about. I mean, there's a chapter in the book called, you know, Rites of Passage, where a man talks about taking his son, overseas, right? Which might be the one of the most greatest sort of insults to black women. But that chapter actually is about men's sort of sense of relationships, the stuff that I think I heard the one sister talking about. Why in the hell do men feel like one of the best ways that they can be a partner or boy to their friends, and in this particular case, perhaps their sons, is by taking them overseas and have these experiences with, you know, these women. So what I want people to get is that there's a number of different sort of aspects about men's lives, from the cradle to the grave, that we just never really talked about. And certainly when it comes to relationships between black men and black women, when it comes to issues of sex and sexuality, I know we were just talking about it, but is it true, that men and women have different sort of standards about what they think is appropriate in sex? That chapter on The Frigid Black Woman was about a man really trying to figure out how in the hell can he be in, I think we were saying, sort of honest and open about, you know, what sort of sexual sex pleases him, right? And I think that it's just very appropriate to say, you know, it's not the time to be having that conversation when you're in bed trying to poke around, you know, and figure out where you can put things. That's so true. Right, that has to happen beforehand. Yeah, but then again, I mean, there are a number of different sort of things that book tries to get at. And I'm going sort of blank. The chapter She Has Attitude, you know, on first read would be a sort of consummate example about how brothers just go off and talk about how black women act a certain way and they angry and mad. But at the same time, what we've never really talked about is men's attitudes. You know,
Jewel, thank you.
Absolutely.
Yes,
Jewel. We never talk about men's attitudes.
We could definitely talk about this all day, but we definitely have to.
You only have an hour.
We have to go, but before we go, I want to know, where can people look for your book, and do you have more books coming out?
Oh, yeah, we got to, you know, way more. I got to pump out. You know, my career is around, you know, sharing with sisters in general, men in particular, these things that we just haven't talked about. So, yeah, there's a lot of more material that we're trying to pump out.
And what's the name of those books?
Where can we find your book?
They're in queue. This particular book, everybody should be able to find it, you know, anywhere you can buy a book. So Amazon.com, Borders, Barnes & Noble. And if you can't find it, you know, then have them order. Certainly go to my website, and it's the last thing I'll put out there, because this is about a larger project. My organization called RenaissanceMailProject.com, for example, is having this larger conversation about sex tourism this month. We have monthly brown bag conversations. So if you go to my website at RenaissanceMailProject.com, you can log in for the national conference that we're having.
Jewel. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jewel, we would love to call you another time when we have other topics relating to some of your books. We'll definitely check out your website. Thank you so much for all your input. We learned a lot in this. And, thank you, and keep doing what you're doing, Jewel. Don't forget to get the book, Don't Blame It on Rio by Jewel Woods. Don't Blame It on Rio. The real deal behind why men go to Brazil for sex. We're going to go to a break. I'm going to change my skirt. I'm hot and sweaty right now. I'm so hot. It's hot in here, right?
Your boobies is sweating. Go wash your thumbs.
You're listening to the Claudia Jordan Show. Call us. Call in 877-2-106-106. We're talking about why men go to Brazil for sex. Why are you here?
Hey.
No, y'all didn't listen.
This is going to be our time, though, if I sing.
Listen.
Sing, goddammit.
I got a replacement waiting.
I love yo, girl.
Oh, yeah,
in a minute.
I thought you were about to freestyle again, Claudia.
Do I need to do everything? I've already taken over the poetry department. Do I need to sing, too?
Why do men go to Rio? Why do men go to Rio for sex? I don't know. Do you bitches know? Y'all don't know.
Because bitches like Portia refuse to give it up.
That's
it's
right.
It's on lock and key.
You're lying to you and to me. You wanna unlock it and take it for a ride. If you don't use it, it's gonna close up inside. Stop telling me you wanna loan it for the weekend. Let me put mileage on your vagina. Cause you ain't, ooh yeah, okay. I don't know where the fuck that came from.
Random. We love it.
I'm so talented.
Girl.
I'm a big celebrity.
Girl. Famousness.
Oh ye of many talents.
How are you still
single?
The
record deals are coming in.
I don't know. I mean, the voice is so smooth and silky.
It is. It is.
I've missed rain.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right.
Men going to sex. Going to Rio what? For sex.
Going to Rio for sex.
Oh,
I thought it was Brazil.
Oh, yeah, that too. Joe from Houston. What's up, Joe? Houston, hey. Texas.
Okay, I went to Rio, and I had some friends that told me about it about 10 years ago. They were in the Navy, and they said that was the best place to go to see the most beautiful women in the world.
And how was your experience?
And it was. And they said, you pick the prettiest woman you think, the most Halle Berry, Beyonce, if the women in Brazil make you kick them in their ass. I said, no way.
And did you have a lot of sex with these women? Did you score?
Yes, I did. I went down the damn thing. But I went to a couple of places. There were women. You thought you were at a Miss Universe contest.
What?
I went to a couple of places in Brazil. You saw women. You thought you were at a Miss Universe contest.
Now, did you have unprotected sex? Or did you
hell no.
Tell the truth.
No.
Every single time you use a condom? There's no baby Country Joe's from Houston down there?
Mm-hmm.
No, it might come up with death that way. No.
condom on your on the mouth too. You know, hey.
Now, did you have a woman when you went down there? Were you married?
Yeah.
No, no, I'm single. My friends that I went were married, so that's in the alias.
How did you feel about seeing your friends that were married, cheating on their wives, and then you go back home and you're playing spades across the table as your boys' wives?
They didn't really do that. They didn't really do that.
Oh, when you're going cow tipping, when you go out, you come back, yeah, get a look at your friend's wives in the eye. Did you feel bad and guilty?
That's foul.
Nope.
He's right. You know what? All right, no deal. All right, we got Marty from Louisiana. Marty.
Marty Mart. No.
I'm not a brother, but I'm a white guy, and I've been to Brazil, been to Thailand, all over the place pretty much.
Hey,
Hey, Marty.
A little flavor.
A little white rapperish kind of
I worked overseas, and it's true. They're beautiful women. My little girl's mama was from Colombia, but I met her here in the States, and just beautiful women, and I scored a bunch.
How much did you pay?
It's crazy.
What's the going rate for some subprime vagina?
Third world vagina.
What's third world vagina going for these days? $250?
No, that's too much.
No, it's cheaper than that.
$50?
Yeah, $5, $10.
$1.29.
So it costs more to fill up my Denali and to get some sex with a third world Brazilian hoe?
I've been to Indonesia and had two girls at the same time for $35.
Wow.
It's not a joke. It's sad.
And it is.
That's why they're over there.
I went in a club and there was like 100 women sitting on the edge of the bar and just pick what you want.
Now, is it like a story to just go up to them and say, hey, come with me? Or does it have to be chemistry? Or do you really feel like these women like you? Or is it just straight up,
it's all about the money? It's all about the money to them.
$35? Mm. $17?
Out here, $35 can't even buy $36.
They got a great hustle, though.
I'm scared the man I like is going to hear this show and leave me for a third world country.
Men are booking your tickets right now.
That's all right.
I think we're advertising a little more.
That's all right, though, because what they bring back is you sure don't want that.
Well, thank you so much for the call. I'm going to go slit my wrist right now. I mean, what do I have to live for? No, seriously, like, they're running mad game, though.
Why marry us?
Like, dudes run game, right? They run it. They got a bunch of females. But these chicks are doing the same thing. Like, yo, let's go. Let's sell it.
For a third less.
Right. For a third less. $17.50. One thing I noticed I did read in the book is that they said they got the bodies of a black woman. And what they're missing from the black woman, which I can kind of agree with some of this a little bit, is the femininity and, like, the feeling of, like, a woman wants to take care of them. And I know that women, like, you know, we're all very career-minded and oriented. So we're like, work, work, work. I got my own shit. You don't got to do it. They don't get that from those girls. They kind of get catered to. And maybe we need to start. I'm gonna start acting broke.
It works.
I'm like, I don't know how I'm gonna pay my rent to my four roommates.
You just don't act like you got your shit together. That's what it is.
Yeah.
If you act like you're in need and act like you can't.
Thank you for the steak. Mm-hmm. I really love Sizzlers.
Cheese bread. They give it to you for free.
Oh my God.
It's so special.
But you can't win. I always thought that if you had your stuff together, you had your own money, and you showed that you were financially independent, you didn't need them, but you wanted to be with them, that would be enough.
Is that attractive
anymore? But men, it's really not, though. Because we look for that in a partner, but men don't look for that. They don't say, we want a girl that has money. Mm-mm. They don't give a shit about that.
Some of them do now.
Well, they care about the money.
We get male gold diggers, but that's a whole other phenomenon that we do address soon, because that's definitely a phenomenon, like getting burnt. But, you know, I done bought dudes rims twice. They go over 30,000.
You know?
I mean, that's a whole other topic. But
crazy.
So at the end of the day, what we learned from this is, don't let your man go to Brazil. Hide his passport.
Absolutely.
Or any of those, go with
him. I mean, make him feel, it seems like they want to feel needed for something. But to me, if I was a guy, I'd be so attractive if my girl had her shit together.
So maybe if you can give them the best of both worlds,
exactly.
Have your shit together, but still have, I believe in traditional roles somewhat. I really do. Like, you know, sometimes you gotta like bend a little bit and do certain things that makes them feel like a king, because men's egos are very delicate.
But just because we act like we got it together, we do, that doesn't mean that we don't want somebody that comes in and says, baby, I got this.
Right.
Yes. Let me help you. Let me handle this for you. We really want that. We don't want to sit here and just carry the whole load.
And I know a few of the women here have a lot of testosterone.
Yeah.
Very extremely deep voices.
With our voices, obviously.
But it's been a great show. We have a sponsor.
Yes.
Barefoot Wine and Bubbly.
Barefoot Wine and Bubbly. They have tons of flavors.
They sponsored us.
They loved us. So.
And you see, we weren't sloppy drunk.
Right.
But I do feel sexual. So it's the perfect drink. So join us every Monday.
And you're sweating between your legs.
7
like
o'clock on the West Coast, 10 p.m. on the East. Give us a call and hit us on the MySpace page at
www.myspace.com/thesinglelifewithcj.
And yeah, befriend us, top 8 us, and join us every week and listen to our topics and hit us with suggestions. And it's been a great show. Thanks. Okay. And Tina Davina got sex. We're going to work on Portia for next time.
Hey.
All right. Cheers for Tina's labia.
Cheers.
Tina
Davina.
Tina's vagina. Wonderful.
Mileage.
All right.
Good one.
Non-random poem next week.
Recycled.